God's people said, amen, amen. Go ahead and please be seated. As you're being seated, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward for our offering this morning. And I'm going to share with you from the book of Matthew when it says, when the evening came, the disciples came to him and said, this place is desolate and the hour is already late, so send the crowds away, but that they may go to the villages and buy food for themselves. But Jesus said to them, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. They said to him, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Ordering the people to sit down on the grass, he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up towards heaven, he blessed the food, and breaking the loaves, he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds, and they all ate, and they were satisfied. They picked up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 full baskets. There were about 5,000 men who ate, besides women and children. Let us pray this morning. Heavenly Father, as we come before you during this time of offering and a continued time of worship, we may just have a representative of 5 loaves and 2 fish. But Father, it's what we have. It's what we're going to give to you, Father. So I pray those who are going to be financially supporting the ministry here at the church, Father, I pray that you speak to their hearts, Father. Father, bless them this morning. And we pray that the tithes that are giving in that aspect, Father, brings glory and honor to your name. Father, we also want to recognize those who are physically contributing to the church, who are physically giving that offering this morning, Father, whatever it may be, to whatever ministry to it reaches, Father, I pray that it reaches the 5,000. Father, for those who are joining me in prayer this morning, Father, I pray that it is our prayer that the gospel of Jesus Christ is proclaimed. Father, we lift up West as he's out in the mission field. Father, I pray that you break down those barriers of language, break down the barriers of the gospel, let your name be proclaimed, Father. And that's my prayer this morning also, that you break down these walls this morning. Whatever walls that are prohibiting us this morning, to allow your name to be proclaimed this morning. Let the words that we sing, the songs that we proclaim, bring praise, honor, and glory to you. Father, this is our time of worship. This is the offering we give. May we honor you this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This is just a love song to the Lord.
Lord, I love you. I just came to tell you. Lord, you're worthy of my praise. I just came to tell you, Lord, you're holy. I just came to say, oh, I love you.
Of our praise, how much you loved us. We can't even begin to show, we can't even begin to express our love back because of your sacrifice that you first showed upon us. Father, it is my prayer that the songs we have sung, that the words we have spoken, not only from our lips but also from our heart, is a true reflection of our praise to you. Father, it's also my prayer this morning that my heart breaks for those who do not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, who has a estranged and struggled relationship with you, Father. So I pray this morning that we draw close to you, that I simply step aside and let your word be proclaimed. Father, we praise you. We love you. We say all this in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, I pray. And all of God's people said, amen. It is great to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Go ahead and turn with me to the book of Acts. We're going to continue on in our little study here in our journey forward together here in Acts chapter 17. Last week, we talked about Paul coming into the city of Athens, and he didn't start saying anything. He started looking around, and we're going to finish off here starting in verse 22. Talking about what he talked about, sharing with you the message that he brought to Mars Hill, which is the Roman god of this Areopagus, there here in the book of Acts here in the city of Athens. Now, I want to make sure to make two corrections. I made an error in the journey guide for you this morning. We're only going to verse 31. Josh told me, where's verse 39 in your Bible? And I said, it wasn't there. So he said, well, I got to make it to 34. I said, well, it should have been 31. So that's all on me. But I also want to draw your attention. You look in this title and say, okay, we're looking to bring the world back to God. And I think there's a consensus that we're broken a little bit, aren't we? The world around us is broken. What was considered immoral is now seems to be acceptable. And so all sorts of things as we look around. And we think that there's a desire to bring the world back to God. But I want to encourage you this morning that there is an instance that, yes, I'm going to be challenging the church to be more missional in bringing the world back to God. However, I want us to understand that in order for us to bring the world back to God, we must recognize that spiritual revival begins with ourselves. Anybody fly on airplanes? Been on an airplane before? Been on an airplane before? And you have that pre-flight takeoff instructions and the guidance? It always boggles my mind why they say that. They say, in case there's an emergency, oxygen masks will come down from the ceiling, right? And their first instructions to say is, make sure you put it on yourself first before you try to help your child or before you try to help anybody else who's not able to do that. And every parent is saying, are you kidding me? There's no way that we're going to do that. Thank goodness I've never had the opportunity, not the opportunity, never had the circumstances. I don't want that opportunity. I'm scared enough of flying, all right? It's even worse when we're landing and the flight attendant says, hey, this pilot wants to give you a friendly reminder that the exits may be located behind you in case of emergency. There's no emergency. We're landing. Sorry. I had to get that off my chest. And so the oxygen masks come down and they say you have to make sure you put it on yourself first. And there's some of you in this room, maybe some of you watching online are saying, I am in no position. I know the world's broken, but I'm broken. And sometimes that spiritual revival begins with ourselves. Maybe this message is nothing about the world. Maybe it's all about where you're at in your spiritual life. And maybe this message is simply for you to get back to God. Maybe it's been a hard time just walking in through those doors. Maybe it's been a long time since we even heard the songs that we have sung. Maybe it's a hard time to... It's been a while since we opened up the book of the Bible. Maybe it's a time to get back to God this morning. And then once we realize, and maybe there's some of us in this room say, yeah, I'm right there with you, Pastor. I'm back with God. I've got a revival in my life. I'm ready to go and be on mission for God. How can I do this? Church, the answer is we must care enough about those around us that we're willing to step in. That is really hard to do. Trust me, that is really hard to do. I'm first and foremost. A lot of times I like to be the bystander. I like to get away from, I don't want to be involved in anything, especially when somebody that I don't know. But at what point are you willing to step in? A lot of times there's this Holy Spirit is pressing on you and says, I need you to move. And so then we have responses, and Pastor Brock mentioned this in his sermons a few weeks ago. Maybe we're like Jonah, and we hear God pressing, say, it's time to step in. I need you to go here. And we're like Jonah and says, nope, I'm out, and we flee. We start fleeing from God. We start fleeing from the situation. I don't want any part of that. Maybe that's not you. Maybe you're kind of like Moses. God's saying, I need you to speak on my behalf. I need you to teach and share what I have laid on your heart. And you're saying, nope, it's not for me. I've got excuses. We find excuses. Not only, we might not be fleeing, we might not be running away, but we're finding excuses on why we can't do that. I don't speak too good. You know, they're not going to relate to me. You know, I'm just too different from somebody else, and they won't understand. Or maybe that's just... whatever excuse why we can't do it. Or maybe you're going to be like Philip. Philip is one of those apostles that doesn't get enough credit. He's one of the 12 of the apostles, and from the very beginning, he was on mission for Jesus Christ. From the very beginning, when he was introduced to Jesus, he goes to Nathanael, and right away he says, we have found the one that they're talking about. We have found the Savior. We have found the Messiah. And then, not only that, later on and early on in the book of Acts, we hear about this Ethiopian eunuch, and God tells Philip, he says, I need you to go and meet this guy. And he sees him. And then when he sees him, he says, I need you to go and join his chariot. And what does Philip do? He runs. Yes, I said that word. He ran to it. He was ran to it. And I want to ask ourselves this morning, is that where we're at this morning? At what point are we really ready to step in? This morning, I want us to dive into God's Word, and I want to read from the book of Acts chapter 17 verses 22 through 31, and we're going to see the three actions needed to get back to God. So whether you have a estranged, if that's the right word, relationship with God, if you're maybe struggling in your relationship, maybe you don't even know what your relationship with God looks like right now, maybe it's not even existent, you're not even sure why you're listening to this guy, the backup pastor, you really thought Pastor Brock was going to be here, and you say, why am I here? I appreciate that. But then you think to yourselves, okay, Pastor, I'm ready, but how can I do this? What's my actions? What's my next steps? Well, let's look in Acts chapter 17 and look at some actions that we need to take in order to get back to God. It begins here in verses 22 and 23. So Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I observe that you are very religious in all respects. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I also found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Therefore, what I proclaim to you in ignorance, this I proclaim to you." Our first action that we need to take, church, in order to get back to God, is we need to change the perspective. We need to change the perspective. We have to understand that faith needs to be more than a religious action. We are really good, church, at doing religious activities. It happened very beginning in the first century here in the book of Acts. Here in Athens, it was all about religious activities. They were so religious. They were doing everything they could. They wanted even to make altars on people that they didn't even know about. They thought they could do enough religious activities and perhaps then they can do enough right things and do enough actions in order to be religious. I wonder, church, if we're not any different this morning. Several weeks ago, we introduced the book called Future Church and where we're looking to go for our church and where we're looking to take our church. And we need to move beyond the religious activities. It's much more than Sunday morning. And I don't know about you, but to be honest, I'm grateful it's much more Sunday morning. Not because Sunday morning is bad. And quite differently, it's because Sunday morning is so great. And there's something more than just this. There's that relationships, those opportunities to engage with one another, to encourage one another, to take this journey together. Being religious doesn't even mean you know God. How many times have you heard about those who are, yeah, I've been going to church for a long time. Yeah, but do you know God? You're a member of First Baptist Church or Second Baptist Church or 10th Baptist Church, but do you truly know God? I've shared this story many times before. In seminary, I took classes on different religions, and I shared with Mormons about their faith. They call me on the phone, poor Mormon guy. He called me on the phone and was trying to talk to me about some of these things, and I started talking back, and I made him stumble on one question. The very simple question, and it's the same question I asked you this morning, differently though. I asked is, why are you a Mormon? And I'm going to ask you this morning too, why are you attending the Journey East Peoria? His first response was, I've always attended. I don't care if you've always attended or not. Why do you believe in what you believe? Second question, his second answer is, well, my parents have always been Mormon, so therefore I've always been. I said, I don't care about your parents. It has nothing to do with about your parents. And so many of us in here this morning saying, well, I'm here because my parents made me come. We had a foreign exchange student. I love her to death. You know how she would go to church? Her grandma would pay her to go to church. Oh, it was great. She thought it was great. Was, hey, I'll give you some money if you come to church with us. Don't get any ideas, kids. Don't get any ideas. You get all this for free. You know, just it's like a bargain for you, right? It has no bearing. And then he goes, well, my grandparents, and then and went through their old genealogy that I don't know, maybe one of them was the second cousin to Joseph Smith. I don't know what the whole story was on why he was Mormon. But I kept pressing in him. I said, but why about you? Why do you believe? And I want to ask the same question to you. Why are you here this morning? Why are you watching online? Because it, trust me, it has nothing to do about the pastor at the podium. It has nothing to do about the songs that we sing. If you're coming here because of us, then we're coming for the wrong reason. We need to change the perspective. What breaks my heart was his final response to me. He says, I'm sorry, I can't answer that question. And he hung up the phone. And so many of us, we're struggling to find the answer. Why do I believe what I believe? Paul's going through Athens, he's walking through and he sees the inscription on an altar to the unknown God. Faith needs to be much more than a religious action. Not only that, but it also needs to be more than wishful thinking. If I put these things here, if I give my sacrifices to this altar, to this unknown God whom I have no idea who he is, what he is, or what he can do, maybe, and I'm wishfully thinking that maybe my life can be changed, my life can be transformed, and we're wishfully thinking, hopefully, that my life can be changed by giving to somebody we don't know, hoping that he can do something we don't even know needs to be done. I'm thinking back in the book of 1 Kings. It was the fire challenge. You thought fire challenges began in Survivor there on CBS? No, it began very beginning. It was God versus Baal, right? If you remember that story back in 1 Kings, you can look it up, chapter 18, verses 20 through 39. That's where I got that 39 coming from. But anyway, whole story. So this whole story, Elijah says, hey, I'm going to make a challenge you. You build an altar for your God, which is Baal. I'm going to make an altar for my God, which is Yahweh, and we're going to see which one is going to consume the altar first. Come down, bring fire upon the altar, have a little barbecue for Father's Day, whatever the case may be, and we're going to see what happens. We're going to see who can listen first, which God is going to appear. If you aren't familiar with the story, that's what happens. They get everything assembled. They start putting the sacrifice on the altar. They start doing all these things. They start crying out to their God, right? They start doing this for hours. You know what Elijah says? He says, maybe your God's sleeping. Maybe you need to yell a little louder. Maybe you need to do something more to catch his attention. So you know what they start doing? They start taking their swords and they start cutting themselves, which, sidebar, is still a practice in some religions today, all trying to get the attention of their Baal, of their God. Finally, night comes down and nothing happens. Then Elijah says, wait just 1 second. And he gets his sacrifice ready. And then he pours it with water, drenches it so much that they actually dug a moat around the altar and it's filled with water. And he calls upon Yahweh, the creators of the heavens and the earth. Not only does God respond in a big and mighty way, but he consumes the water-soaked sacrifice. He consumes all the water in the moat. And he says, I am God. This morning, maybe you need to change your perspective. Maybe stop wishful thinking that it may change. Start believing in the one true God. And maybe it's the beginning and we start pursuing a relationship with God. Verse 23 says these words, the God who made the world and all things in it. Verse 24, it says, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. Verse 26, he made from one man every nation of mankind, and to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation, so that they would seek God, if perhaps they might even grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and exist, and even some of your own poets have said, for we also are his children. being then the children of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and thought of man. Sometimes I wonder, as I look at the landscape of the church, have we forgotten who we worship? Have we forgotten who we worship? Scripture says that God will never leave us nor forsake us. Yet time after time again, we act like God isn't here. We're much like the Israelites when God has taken too long and Moses has taken too long there on Mount Sinai. And says, well, maybe he's just gone. Maybe he's died, so we got to do something. And they start creating golden calves and start making these idols and start worshiping them. Maybe that's what we do. Even though God says, I'm never going to leave you nor forsake you. Yet we abandon him because we don't feel like he's here. We don't feel like he's in our lives. God says he will never leave us or forsake us. I want to ask this question, and I think about this maybe a little bit differently. Men, I want to ask this question to you. Do you pursue a relationship with God with the same intensity that you pursue your spouse or your girlfriend? Do you pursue God with the same intensity as you pursue your work or your hobby? Women, do you pursue a relationship with God with the same intensity that you pursue or pursue your spouse, your boyfriend? Do you pursue God with the same intensity as you pursue your work, your hobby? Youth, I haven't forgot about you. Do you pursue a relationship with God with the same intensity that you pursue your grades in school, that you pursue your sports or your activities or your video games? I don't know about you, but that's pretty intense when we do those things. What if we take that same intensity and pursue God? What should we be pursuing about God? Our relationship with God should be defined by knowing him. Take a look what it says in verses 24 through 27. That God made the world and all things in it. God made the world and all things in it. That takes a lot. That speaks a lot because, A, that means that there are no mistakes. God didn't say whoops. No, God knew what he was doing. He knew what he was making. He created the world and all those that are in it. Since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, he does not dwell in temples made with human hands. Nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. Do you know the power of God? God doesn't need me. God doesn't need me. We sang a song earlier this morning that you actually walked by it. You didn't even notice that you walked by it. It's a big tradition, a long-standing tradition here at Richland Baptist Church. It's those rocks back there on the back table. They used to be up here. We'll probably bring them back up here eventually. Those rocks, what are those rocks all about? Well, when Jesus was coming in to Jerusalem for the very last time, the Pharisees and the religious leaders telling Jesus, hey, silence your apostles, silence your disciples from praising your name. You need to quiet them down. You know what Jesus says? If they fall silent, these rocks will cry out. God doesn't need us to do what he's going to do. But he wants us to do his work. Our relationship with God should be defined by knowing him. We need to know his power. He created everything out of nothing. He created it for you. He created, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. Then he continues on in saying, he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation. Not only do we need to know his power, but we need to know his purpose. You look at this word, habitation. He created us and He put us in, He knows our habitation, the boundaries of their habitation. What is the habitation? What, look at that word and you start breaking that down. Here's what this word means. In simple word, is dwelling. But I like really what it really goes to. If you really break it down, in very simple English, down homing. Down homing. It sounds interesting. It means that's where you're being established. That's where you is your home. It's where you are dwelling. It's much more than just a place to stay. Your dwelling is not your hotel, which you stay at on vacation. That's not your dwelling. No matter what you bring to that hotel to make it look like home, not if you bring your favorite picture, you put it on the nightstand, not that you bring your PlayStation 2 or whatever things you bring from home, not even your own blanket and pillows that we bring on vacation. That doesn't make it our habitation. Why? Because we're not dwelling there. We're not dwelling. We're just staying there. There's a difference. God knows where we should be dwelling. Not just being, but actually dwelling. Taking ownership. Establishing your life. But so many times we get into our trouble when we start going our own way. So many times God says, I need you to be here. And we start running away. Well, maybe we can do the exact same thing over here. No, that's just where you're going to be staying. I need you to dwell. Take up residence. Then look what it says. This is a very powerful statement, verse 27. He did all this so that they would seek God, if perhaps they might even grope for Him and find Him, though He is not far from each one of us. He wants us to seek Him in such a way that we can touch Him or feel Him. When we get to that point of faith, then our relationship with God should be defined by finding Him. Because in Him we live. In Him we live. What does that mean? That means we are living. We are full of life. But so many of us are living like we're on death row, like we're dead men walking. We're crying out saying, dead man walking, dead man walking. Why? Because we have no life. Because we're not living in Him. In Him, there is life. In Him, we live. In Him, we move. In Him, we move. Sometimes we Baptists, we don't move enough. Uh-oh. You a little charismatic up here in this place? Come on. Why are we stagnant? Why are we just sitting still? Because in Him, we can't sit still. In Him, we cannot be contained. Look back earlier in the text where Paul was preaching to him. It says, God cannot be contained in these four walls, and yet we act like He is. And yet we cannot move, like we're restrained by ourselves. We put up imaginary boundaries, imaginary chains holding us back because we're afraid of what might happen. We're afraid about start moving and being stirred by the Holy Spirit because in Him we live, in Him we move, and in Him we exist. Without Him, this is going to sound weird, without Him, we aren't. Without Him, we aren't. But in Him, we are. In Him, we exist. We have life, and we have life abundantly. Not only do we need to change our perspective, not only do we need to pursue a relationship with God, last but not least, I'm going to close with this. We need to repent from our unrighteousness and receive salvation. Repent from unrighteousness. Verses 30 through 31, Paul concludes his little sermon in verse 30 by saying these words, therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, praise be to God. How many times God has overlooked my times of ignorance? My times where I'd worship without even knowing, just going through the motions and wishfully thinking. But therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent. That is the reason why we commissioned west off to go to Zambia. We lift him up in prayers as he's going to preach the gospel to all people everywhere, including in East Peoria or in Zambia. That here's what we are proclaiming, that all people should repent. Why? Why should we offer the opportunity to repent? Why should we ask people to repent? And it's very simple. Repentance is the opportunity to return to God. Repentance is the opportunity to return to God. I speak from experience. A lot of times I don't repent because I like doing things on my own. I don't want to admit my mistakes. I don't want to admit that I might be lost. I don't want to admit that I did something wrong. I don't want to admit that I need help. So many of us are like the prodigal son. He says, "Give me my inheritance. Give me all the riches that I have so I can live my life." And that's what we do. And we live life. We love it. We enjoy the riches and just all the things that the world has offered to us. But there comes in a moment in our life where we cannot be satisfied by the world. There comes to a moment in our life, it doesn't matter how much money I had, I cannot be satisfied by the things in which I can spend on it. Next thing I know, I'm broke, I'm desperate, and I'm still in the same situation without life, without movement, without existence. And we need to be just like the prodigal son and think to ourselves, wait a second, here I am struggling all on my own, thinking that there should be something better for my life because I have a Father in heaven who's given me a purpose and a life. And maybe I just maybe need to return. And say, "Father, I'm sorry for I have sinned against you. I'm sorry I have failed in my disobedience." What's amazing about the story of the prodigal son is that the son never gets the opportunity to say anything. Because as soon as he's coming back home, as soon as the father sees him walking, he's running towards you. And this is something that maybe sometimes we forget about in our pursuit in a relationship with God, is that God is pursuing that exact same relationship with you. He's pushing and pursuing. He wants you to have him in his life. Repentance is the opportunity to return to God. Secondly, I want to ask this question. If someone was to define your life, if somebody was to define you or tell me about you, would this word, would this one word characterize your life? Righteous. Would the word righteous be used to define your life? It's a very important question. It's a very important question because here's what the psalmist says in Psalm 37. "For the Lord loves justice and does not abandon his godly ones. They are protected forever, but the descendants of the wicked will be eliminated. The righteous will inherit the land and dwell in it forever." Are you righteous to be one of the inhabitants of the land which God has prepared for us to dwell in it forever? A lot of us think we do. I thought I did. I thought I was righteous enough. We do all the right things. We do all the good things. We keep most of the Ten Commandments. We read the Bible every once in a while. We go to church when we can. We do all the right things. We don't swear. We don't do drugs. We stay out of trouble. If the world were to look at us and say, "Boy, he is a Christian," we think to ourselves, that's okay. Here's the problem. The world has the wrong idea about what Christianity is all about. You know what some parts of the world really thinks that Christianity is all about? MTV. They say, well, that's America, that's the world, that's what Christianity is all about. You know what God calls us to be? He calls us to be righteous. And I don't know about you, but so many times in my life, in my desire to be righteous and a desire to be a follower of God, I'm just like a mountain climber making a couple climbs up, but then all of a sudden I lose my grip and I start sliding down. And I realize in my life that there is no much righteousness in my life that I can do to inherit the eternal life that God has given me. Instead, repentance not only is the opportunity to return to God, not is it that leads to righteousness, but repentance recognizes the risen Savior. How do we become righteous then if I cannot do it on my own? Righteousness then is described here, Romans chapter 5. For while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly, for one will hardly die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. For while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Not only this, but we also celebrate in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. As we conclude our message this morning, we're going to have a time of invitation, and I want to conclude it the exact same way that Paul concluded his sermon to the men in Athens, to the people in Athens. He says, every man should repent because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. Church, there is a time coming in which we will be judged, and God will say, why should you spend eternity with me in heaven? And if we begin by saying, well, I've done all the right things, I've helped all the older ladies across the street, I even opened the doors for someone, I even did this or did that, I did all the dishes this week, or I did all those things. If anything that we have done is the beginning of our statement on why we shall have eternal life with Christ Jesus and our Savior and the eternal Father, then we've already been not righteous enough. Because I can't do it on my own. I need the Savior, Jesus Christ. I believe without a shadow of doubt that Jesus Christ lived a perfect life. He healed the sick, made the lame walk, and let the blind see. And he was crucified on the cross for someone just like me. He wasn't crucified out of obligation. Wasn't crucified out of disobedience. Wasn't crucified in hopes that we would do something else in order to inherit eternal life. He was crucified, dead, rose from the dead, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. By his blood we have been redeemed. The question is, will you believe this morning? We're going to sing a song this morning. There's only one name you have to say. It's Jesus. There's something about that name, that with that name there is hope. With that name there is life. With that name there is joy. Do you have that this morning? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in this time of worship. I don't know what you have brought us here this morning. I don't know who you have brought here for this moment in time. But your scripture says you have appointed every time. You have appointed every position, every opportunity right here this morning, Father. And there is someone here, whether they're watching online or they're here in person, that needs to proclaim that you are their Lord and Savior for the very first time this morning. We need to repent of our darkest of sins and quit shoving it under the rug or behind the closet. Father, we just simply need to cry out, Jesus. 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 Because we believe in his life, we believe in his sacrifice, and we believe in the truth that God raised you from the dead. So Father, this morning, for those who did not know you as a personal Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that you press on them to make a decision to repent and receive righteousness. Father, for someone in this room, they need someone to step beside them and make their journey with them. Father, I pray that church members are able to stand beside them and help them along the way, to pray with them, to encourage them, to lead them to you. Father, in this time of worship, in this time of invitation, we surrender ourselves to you. May you work in this place. I pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, I pray. Amen. This time is open. If you need to come and pray, I'll be glad to pray with you. You need to make a decision for Jesus Christ or make a decision to be baptized, I'd be glad to share with you with that, whatever that means. If you want somebody else to pray with you, let's take this time. Let's surrender ourselves to him. You come as we sing.